Welcome everyone to the promised continued microkernel discussion. And I realize it usually takes really quite some time for people to tune in here with YouTube notifications and such. But anyway, you can watch it time shifted on demand, and best don't forget to share, like, and subscribe and ring this, click this doorbell icon notification things here, so to really get all notifications. And this will be not a super long stream today because I have other stuff to finish and do and such real life, but I wanted to share here some notes, and I share them. By sharing them, I risk, of course, two things. Welcome in the audience, everyone, Danny. And so why do I share these ideas? First of all, I could, of course, keep all these ideas to myself and maybe eventually in a 2 years, three or so, come to the market with the most amazing operating system. But first of all, I'm not sure if I will ever have enough time for this. Certainly, I'm not stupid. All of these ideas and projects are huge. A dream would, of course, be to have either enough YouTube income or make a new startup, but whatever. Anyway, not the greatest fan of patents, and then if some of these ideas here are not yet published in patents, then make you also some prior art. So if you in some years need to look for prior art, because I made already another microkernel summary, why are we even talking about this? All the haters, of course, always say all the performance. We need a monolithic kernel like the Linux kernel, where everything is in one huge thing. Like, I hope you know how it is with the Linux kernel. What are the benefits? Benefits, of course, we have a super connected world. All of the software is super huge, and we have security vulnerabilities everywhere. There are people make typos and bugs and such. So even in the Linux kernel and the surrounding software, Apache, GNU, libc, Firefox, you name it, security holes everywhere. And wouldn't it be nice if all of this stuff would be a little bit more shielded? Let's just, for the sake, this is unrelated, but just to have here some concept a little bit shielded. This is unrelated transmitter code morphing, but just to have here some diagram, can't make here all the diagrams up here. But the idea would be, independently of this diagram, to have some microkernel and all the drivers. Of course, here's the processor and BIOS, but just ignore this. Just imagine, like it is, you can also read microkernel. To summarize my earlier talks, but the problem is if I summarize all the ideas, there will be another 30 minutes gone. So I rush here through. My idea is also, I of course realize we have code duplication starting from the bootloader, I grew up to a super huge, maybe 50 megabyte or something extracted, something like this, need to up. Maybe for the next talk I compile real numbers for everything, but I think the grub was 50 mbit. We actually could theoretically, do I have here a kernel, a terminal laying around here at hand? Yeah, here's a root terminal, at least something. What am I showing even? Need to optimize here my monitoring situation. So we can actually have here some real numbers. So download mirror grub then download grub and Linux. And here, of course, this is a wrong grub. We want grub 2 though. And my idea is already, when I see all this code duplication, an idea of a microkernel system would already be that we could, if we really wanted to do it modern and amazing without all the code duplication, we could have already the same drivers for serial ATIA in the bootloader and effectively make our microkernel the bootloader. This might sound crazy, but there are cases of Linux, like proof of concept, Linux boot, or what this was. Nowadays it is also used, not even a decade ago, in the PF3 with Petit Boot, but I think I saw that even today Petit Boot is nothing else than a Linux kernel used as a bootloader. So you load a special Linux flavor in your ROM and use this for booting and execute if you, and in the PS3, I think Sony and those people have done it not to have all the hypervisor driver in a bootloader and in the Linux kernel. So it's not like there are not cases like this. And why not with a microkernel design it so that it actually really is like this all over the place. So mirror grub 2, here you have it recompressed. It's This is of course recompressed. Do I have a tar that directly can extract this? Maybe we have disk use, so we have 46 megabyte, didn't make that up. Just to have here some real numbers. And of course the Linux kernel, while we are at it, then I don't have to recompile the numbers here, Linux 5 something. And this of course extracting takes a while because it's simply so huge. I think it will be 700 megabyte maybe, at least, whatever, we will see. And you see how huge this is, and then you see in another live stream someone in the audience was already joking, do we have a Linux release now each and every day? Yes, it feels like it, nearly approaching that. Oh, nearly a gigabyte, I already misremembered, but now that I see it, I remember, yes, it was nearly a gigabyte, so I don't make this up. So one monolithic kernel, of course this is PowerPC and all the drivers, but you name it. And this is where also maybe this live stream dies again with TG3 bugs, which by the way I think I rebooted now with IOMMU disabled. Maybe it's really IOMMU. And there you see even huge used server grade TG3. I think at least this TJ server grade is server grade. Anyway, even famous Ethernet drivers, even today we have here bugs with TG3, because why not in the Linux kernel? And of course, I'm not naive, I do 20 years of Linux with some excursions to macOS and such. And to summarize this, my idea would be, if I would start something from scratch nowadays, I would make it so that we have the bootloader, like directly loading some microkernel thing and modules for BIOS, EFI and drivers, just like grub also has drivers. And by having to rewrite them, just share them and make it a really nice modular reusable structure with, of course, the microkernel only. I set this here, bootloader, FS, and chicken and egg, of course, bootstrapping, how should this be loaded and such, but probably just like grub 2, some modules packed together for initial bootstrap and booting, like modules for file system, serial ATA, you name it, just like an initrd, and that's it. I think I read somewhere, I've not seen much of QNX, but I think I read somewhere that QNX also has some preloadable module stuff. Then I would make everything, I would mimic here this proc file system, which by the way came from Plan 9, I think, for the most part, for those who have not seen this already. Okay, Plan, can you also load? So much to the preparation, thank you. This comes from rebooting without IOMMU for the potential hope of improved TG3 reliability. And Plan 9, I think they innovated here further, as far as I remember. I can't remember everything of all the stuff I read and see each day, but I think they mostly had here everything as a file even more, and also the proc file system. So I think the Linux kernel only has a proc file system also inspired from Plan. And nowadays, in my opinion, we have there quite of a mess with slash proc slash the newer slash this. Also, I wonder why have they not cleaned up and made everything in proc, and this is a little bit superfluous. On top of, you can mount the debug FS to this kernel debug or something, this debug FS, because can't have enough proc, this and debug file systems apparently. So as far as I know, even in Plan 9, maybe even Windows are regular files. Not sure if we will find this here. Maybe even network connections, like say maybe they even have TCP IP as network connections or something, as far as I remember. Also what we still use today, even today, the Linux kernel and QEMU has the 9P protocol, which is a service as a file to other programs, unified protocol. And then of course union directories and namespaces and stuff. Maybe I will try this out, a really long time since I last tried it, maybe 10 years ago or something, for a test in an emulator. But there you see, it's not like nobody has done something like this before. It is just like, it would also be amazing if we have a real modern system here from scratch, and everything in some unified dev or something, or maybe make it slash this only problem. Actually, maybe, but this is only nitpicking or naming. Actually, this has no influence in the performance or function. I would naturally make it slash this, but this of course would not be compatible with old-fashioned programs expecting slash dev. So maybe one thing would be to make it slash dev and put there also all the other exposed stuff, because I would make it so that all your drivers expose here block devices and such. So because in a microkernel, all your processes are, all your drivers are regular or should be regular processes. And then this would, in my opinion, also not only increase stability, but also make driver development easier. Nowadays in Linux, we have, by the way, maybe I find a diagram for this. If you look on the Linux architecture for graphic driver, you have the kernel, kernel mode setting, and then libdrm, xorg driver, and mesa. So maybe we can quickly find here some Linux graphic diagram or some sort of this. And this is quite complex, actually. Let's see, do we have here something? Maybe this, actually. And when you take a look on the complexity of this, not only is it actually, here's even with Wayland. Let's open this even larger. Is this nicely on screen? Maybe, maybe not. And what? And there you see all the people who tell me, but the performance, look on the separation of stuff. And again, separation is not bad, but in my opinion, we mix, we do not really get the best of everything in the Linux kernel, because we still have mostly this monolithic thing, and everything you need to have on your graphic stuff, you need to have in your kernel. And by the way, for those who don't know what this direct graphic renderer manager is doing in the kernel, it needs to verify and validate all the commands, because if you would not have this as kind of verification process, because the user space, obviously, as you see in this super complicated program, you have here a 3D engine, I hope it's on screen though, and it is writing directly to this dev files, this direct rendering interface, and here libgl and mesa and libdrm and stuff. And this, of course, should write directly to the hardware as directly as possible. And for this, this would be insecure, because all the, after the first generation, after the 3DFX and maybe even Voodoo, the later, the second generation of cards at least had DMA, direct memory access. And if drivers like games would directly write to the registers of the cards, they could basically direct memory transfer memory from all over the place and DMA your passwords and security keys. And this is why the DRM needs to verify all the commands there, and this is where we have it there. And again, of course, we need something like this, but maybe the whole infrastructure would be much nicer if we would have here some mesa. Of course, we still would need to trust the driver. The problem is, of course, you always need to trust the driver, but in my opinion, it doesn't matter if you have a user, like user process in quotes, driver that has the same functionality. It doesn't matter if it's running isolated in user space, like even in some modern Windows versions, than in kernel anyway. And I would trust this even more, because in kernel, one typo in all this 3D command verification can crash your whole kernel. And of course, there are, with each kernel release, fixes for things like this usually. And then I would rather have this in user space, and like on maybe modern Windows systems where the graphic driver can crash and be restarted, have such a situation, then saying it's not safe in user space because user space can do everything. Yes, but in kernel we can do everything anyway. And then if we have a trusted, it's not like a Firefox can load and access your PCI registers and stuff. Of course, it would only be the trusted system processes on boot up or such. It doesn't really, in my opinion, it doesn't matter if you can load loadable kernel drivers or if you can access user space, PCI stuff for DMA, direct memory transfer and such. In my opinion, it would make this whole setup here much more streamlined if you would not have all these different things of DRM and kernel, libdrm, mesa. You see so many different things there in place on a modern, this is actually quite an interesting, nice matching graphic there for that. And you see so many separations that, in my opinion, those people who tell me about the performance here, but the performance of this situation, not really sure if this is a better performance anyway. So this is just a brief overview to recap why I think this is a good idea. And in my opinion, why do I make these talks? Yes, I could implement this, but I have other things to do, my main commercial work and making educational videos. And if someone follows here these guides and makes the most amazing system, so be it. Maybe I do it in a year. You see, I compile more low-level code also for 3D stuff. We will continue more sound, more modern stuff in the next months to come. So this year we will for sure have a couple of more drivers, maybe low level for the early Matrox cards, and also S3DFX Voodoo, and maybe early ATI and NVIDIA card, just for the completeness sake, just some bit BLT, blitting, filling, 3D triangles and stuff. But this is of course not the whole kernel. We will also continue here the next time, not because right now we run the bare metal stuff in DOS for the sake of testing. We will soon switch to have an own multi-boot specification, bootloader, and do this and do the PCI stuff, interrupt stuff, and have here some small educational stuff. And what I wanted to say is some crazy ideas. This was just a summary in 15 minutes. Okay, not too bad, I hope. And again, this would be similar like Plan 9, where you would have most things as files and you would still open. This would actually look quite like Linux, actually. You would have slash dev, slash SCSI, whatever, block. Doesn't matter what you name it. This part would be still similar. And in my opinion, for example, user space driver could create its entries there. And in my opinion, would not be maybe not too bad if you have slash dev, slash block, IDE0 or whatever, and have there your device nodes for the partitions accompanying directly some statistic files, that it's not separated like in proc today. In my opinion, maybe not too bad if you have this all together and directly see this is your IDE device, this is your device nodes, this are your partitions, and this are other additional control and statistic things just directly next to it. Why not? And I wanted to say here one thing. I had, some ideas, was thinking how many, because the naysayers always say, but the performance, yes, but I say, but the security and stability, I would actually take stability and security over 15 or 20% of performance, which we lose now anyway with Intel Spectre and Meltdown security vulnerabilities anyway. And again, you could make this, I made here already some things. You could have a lot of stuff like dynamic libraries, so device drivers in the kernel could load really nice libraries for this, like working with partitions, also the multiple device stuff, the RAID stuff could be very nicely programmed, in my opinion, also with maybe some C++ or something. And now comes the crazy idea. In this setup, just like the Linux kernel, you've seen this with my video with PCI path through and user space I mentioned, with this virtual in user space PCI access that QEMU also uses for PCI path through. It is not a requirement that these drivers are all written in C. I made here already a note long time ago in February there in this last flight and light stream. I noted here directly these drivers do not need to be written in C and C++ when they are in user space. And I actually have experience. I hereby disclose that the new drivers in our exact scan, not the shameless self-promotion, but that's just reality. But anyway, our amazing exact scan with nearly 500 reverse engineered scanner drivers, and some of them are written, the new ones are written in Lua, and it is amazing. I would never go back. The old ones are written in C++ with my heritage. They're insane drivers. My initial open source drivers are C and still open source, insane. On each Linux CDs, open source driver C and insane. For a vision OEM drivers in open source, nearly 200, commercial over 400, and plus the Lua drivers. And Lua we have written, I hereby disclose, we have Lua drivers running in our exact scan and written in Lua, and it is amazing. And this is why I want to share this word and also inspire people to do new crazy things, because this is so much faster to develop, so less crash prone, error prone, no buffer overruns left and right. This is simply amazing. And I do not say this needs to be written in Lua just because I like Lua as a small and beautiful simple language, just to inspire you. And by the way, Java only, I hate Java. Java is a slow piece of garbage, but you could theoretically do it. And pro bono thing, this drivers, if you write quite a lot of drivers in something like Lua, and by the way, you could just interim compile it. And here comes the next crazy idea. It doesn't need to be slow. First of all, the drivers usually don't do much. They just pass some values around. There comes some block of memory that needs to be written to the serial ATA drive. You just fill some registers in memory mapped IO. You can also do this with some 10 lines of Lua, no problem. And not a huge performance impact, but if you want performance, just in-time compile this. And then, how amazing is this? You have a microkernel. So of course you need a native microkernel compiled for Spark and MIPS and ARM and such, but your drivers, many of the drivers could actually be completely portable, like serial ATA, you know, the USB even, the Universal Host Controller Interface, AHCI for serial ATA, NVMe for such. Those drivers, theoretically, you don't need to recompile for all of the systems, and I will probably start toying with this. I disclosed already some patent ideas. We are in our exact scan, we are using the regular Lua with some modifications for better bit fiddling, some sort of better integrated bit operation thing there, and some other nice fancy tricks and features, but we are not using Lua JIT, and I started to write a JIT compiler, I hereby also disclosed, but this is not such a surprise because fun projects before I started to spend all my time on YouTubing, and just this idea are on my blogs. I disclosed here already some JIT idea because even for just-in-time compiling I have some amazing ideas. And I disclosed here some ideas in NovelFast JIT, and I disclosed this here just because I did not want to. I don't have the time if I already work 75 hours on my company, some 25 hours on open source, and in the meantime YouTube streaming, I already literally have nearly no other time, so I can't write research papers and fill out patent applications. By the way, I hate patents. Go with your patents wherever you want, shoot them to Moon or Mars, but let me in peace with them. So I already some years ago, and didn't make this up, you probably hopefully find this with the archive internet engine thing there. Where is the date here even? Why is here? Here, 2014, so this idea is over. Hey, this idea is 5 years old in the meantime, probably. Yeah, still not finished this because so many other things. But in theory, I want my own JIT thing and not like LLVM C-Lang, but like super simple, like Lua JIT, but I don't like Lua JIT. What I disclosed here is that Lua JIT, for example, Lua JIT is first interpreting, and also Lua JIT has a pure interpreter mode that is, of course, completely slow. And only if it detects some reoccurring hot loop or code path or whatever, it is then jitting this. And my idea is, which I because the problem with this is, and we digress a little bit, but I try to speak fast today and make this here 45 minute max live stream to summarize here all of my ideas fast. And if it's too fast, you can watch it again with slower speed. So my idea is that I don't like to implement an interpreter with the hot path detection thing. So my idea is, why should I waste all this effort in an interpreter if I later need to write in just-in-time compiler anyway? So my idea is here to just-in-time compile this always in a really fast, like, because the point is interpretation is slow, so why not always just-in-time compile it in a really fast and crude manner that is like mostly only like writing out atomic bundles of instructions that your interpreter would do anyway. And my thinking is that it would save having an interpreter. You get rid of all the interpreter logic. You have only just-in-time compiler simplifying this, in my opinion. And then you have the benefit of that the non-really jitted, not like the really optimized code, is not as slow as an interpreter. By the way, I show the right camera. And then you would still have this hot code detection, and then if a code path is really hot, then you just in time compile this again with really fancy optimizations. In my opinion, this could theoretically improve the performance of the interpreted slow code paths and keep this still stupid simple and still be amazing. And maybe one time, this is also why again, try to get here some funding. This is also why I had this transmitter slides open. In my opinion, Java is not the best example for this because, in my opinion, I usually have seen Java doc slow. I don't want to have something as slow as Java, obviously. But then again, people also say Java can be fast, but maybe then it is also that the Java foundation and libraries are so huge. Maybe in general, you need to keep this stupid simple and not over design this, and that your just-in-time compiler is just shitty, or it's just overload. Your just-in-time compiler is always busy recompiling all your huge frameworks. Then of course it's super slow, and Transmeter has shown, of course, as we're not the most high performance CPUs, that that's what I said, I think, comments in the audience. And of course, Transmeter CPUs were not the most high performance, but the Crusoe was, I mean, surprisingly okay, and the Efficient was much better. Of course, not state-of-the-art territory, but performance was I showed you here some things, not the slowest and surprisingly fast. And they use, and by the way, I would even really like if you would see processors like this, you could maybe even fix Meltdown and Spectre bugs better if you would be, and by the way, internally modern Intel CPUs are also with a more risk-like engine and compiling to internal microcodes anyway, or microops and such. So modern CPUs are not that different, only that they do the code morphing in quotes in hardware with this very small microcode cache and such. Maybe this would still be beneficial, and maybe if you would spend as much resources as Intel and AMD, this would have even state-of-the-art performance, maybe. But I will, the one thing I will not do, by the way, I will not end up in CPU manufacturing. Making amazing software and operating systems is enough for me already for the next decades, and would be amazing if people try this out again. There are rumors that the Nvidia, whatever, ARM CPU has such a setup, like transmitter code for morphing. Maybe I read rumors there, whatever the name of this transmitter thing, Nvidia thing was. Anyway, this is why I had the slide open, to show you this code morphing software. So it's not, but by the way, it is not that I want this to have always this. It's just you have the option. You don't need to do it like this. Of course, you can write classic drivers, nothing is stopping you to write this in C and C++, but the options are there. And in my opinion, many of the drivers, like USB, some serial dongle, you don't need to recompile your serial driver and all the other, or GPIO, like flashing an LED. Don't need to have a most high performance C++ driver. Beside, most of the stuff is not even high performance. By the way, I wanted to show you that there was some great language shootout benchmark, but unfortunately they removed LuaJIT some years ago, I think. So I would now only have a chance to open this in the Internet Archive, I think. But because LuaJIT was in some of these micro benchmarks in this great language shootout some years ago, LuaJIT was at the last revisions back in the day. LuaJIT, oh yeah, not the wrong camera here. LuaJIT was often the fastest, surprisingly, so much to that. Unfortunately, for some strange reasons, they have removed this there. But there, on a quick Googling, I found here some article. Anyway, when foreign function FFI interface function calls beat native C, it's just here one data point, because unfortunately, as I said, they have removed the great language shootout thing there. So he created a shared object containing a simple C function, and then he called them with LuaJIT and this was substantially faster than C, like 25% in this dynamic foreign function phase. That's just some thing here, that just in-time compiled stuff does not need to be slower if you make this keep it stupid simple like LuaJIT. And just that, by the way, of course LuaJIT is amazing, just of course I always find something to nitpick it. And also anyway, for maintainability and other reasons, we didn't want to use it. And by the way, you see, even for our scanner drivings, our scanner drivers are even amazingly fast. It's not like they are not even just in-time compiled in ExactScan right now, and the performance is okay. It's not even, no user ever realized that some of those drivers are written in Lua and interpreted only because we use a standard C Lua in there for portable reasons and safe mind. But coming back to this, this is just some crazy ideas that I thought would be worth exploring and would be really amazing if you update, because now when I update the Linux kernel, I compile here a fast Ryzen compiles 20 minutes or something on an all modules just in case Linux kernel on a 16 thread Ryzen, and it's of course slightly wasteful, and I would really like when we would have a little bit more like Windows or Mac OS, only gradual updating the microkernel and not all the drivers. Another thing, so this was the biggest thing I wanted to say here, another optimization I said already earlier, this was in my initial talk already, that this IOCTLs to optimize performance and throughput in a really modular multi-server microkernel. I disclosed here the idea of bundled IOCTLs, so that you do not do IOCTL for one thing, but you can group them in some memory binary packet layout kind of thing or whatever means. And with this, you could bundle multiple operations in such kind of high performance manner. And if even if you have more context switches due to a microkernel, you could even, if you design this well, you could even in some micro benchmarks come out ahead if you design some micro benchmarks with a load that is grouping IOCTLs and you issue like open, read, write, whatever in one context switch to your file system server or something like this, you could have even better performance. And there you see, in my opinion, if you have such a setup that is not as monolithic as Linux kernel, you can even do research and performance experiments much easier. And the way I will probably go with this, of course, I know this is a huge undertaking, and I just wanted to share some inspiration for the next generation of operating system developers who maybe want to try more modern takes to this and not this old-fashioned monolithic Unix kernel kind of thing. And the same goes in this way with this bundling to your graphics server. If you have a graphics server, and I would probably implement it so for performance reasons that you have a graphics server like Xorg and have this drivers loadable there like AMD GPU and whatnot. And of course they need to memory map this, but again, if you DMA this in kernel or in your trusted Windows server, in my opinion, this is the same level of safety, doesn't matter in my opinion. And maybe it is safer if it has less typos, if you write this in C++ or something with a little bit more type checking and more fancy frameworks who avoid some errors and typos and mistakes. Maybe it is even more stable and less randomly crashing than this old-fashioned Cygnus Linux kernel. And again, in my opinion, but comment this below, why should this be less safe in modern systems? Theoretically, you could even isolate this with an IO MMU, just like with QEMU GPU PCI pass-through. But even if you don't have this, if you have this in kernel or as an isolated user space process, if you don't allow Firefox to claim this PCI device, in my opinion, still safe enough. And then you could have a really nice modern Windows server with all the 3D stuff multiplexed there, even multi-threaded, which a lot of stuff is often not multi-threaded in Linux, and even do there all kind of fancy optimizations already, and maybe avoid some overhead of re-verifying, because right now the Linux server and 3D stuff is writing to the direct rendering interface and the kernel is re-verifying all the commands, so much to the performance advantage, maybe not. So the way I will probably do this, because I'm well aware that this is a multi-decade kind of project, especially nowadays everything gets so complicated, even writing USB host controller interface and NVMe and serial ATA takes a month here and a couple of other months there. The way I will probably go for this is I will continue making educational videos. I will low level, just for the fun and experimentation, do drivers for S3DFX Voodoo and maybe even Matrox and stuff, and also definitely IDE and serial ATA. And I will probably switch, because right now there are DOS drivers there in my vintage stuff with toying with S3 Verge cards and such, and I will probably make it so that this code becomes mostly header only, that there is a 3D Verge header and serial ATA like AHCI for the advanced host control interface for serial ATA. And I will play with this on DOS for the testing and make this header only so that we can reuse all those tested register definitions and make it so that independently of this DOS vintage code testing bare metal stuff and this microkernel, that this code in headers, there's this movement also on GitHub and the internet with even C++ algorithms like setlib algorithm in one header and JPEG algorithm in one header and stuff like this. And I will probably try to do this, a reusable register definition and reusable code and filling the structure there of this memory mapped IO registers and stuff, like just like you have seen in my vintage DOS cards. And I will gradually migrate all of this to have a maintainable structure of Rosetta code, so to say, of header only device driver interface stuff or readable C++ like code to get more of this stuff going, testing and more people to try, because then you can take this freestanding headers with just very minimal PCI definitions and such and register level definitions, and people can experiment with this not only for their DOS and vintage tinkering but also modern operating system designs. I think this could be totally amazing. and a really nice, not only educational, but long-term viable strategy to as a hobby so far. Who knows what this becomes in a couple of year time. Build here something. And in this experiment, I will probably, what I also had in my mind already for quite a long time, with these applications, did I have this here already somewhere, all this, what I built in my other secondary stream here, testing with Musel and this core utils like LS, I don't know if I have somewhere on this huge map here, a node somewhere, maybe not, but all of those usual programs that you have like LS and stuff, that on my other secondary live stream were miscompiled. I made the experiments with Musel, this alternative C library, and LLVM Cling, and right now 64-bit works. Well, it's not amazing, not the most clean bootstrap procedure, but whatever, at least it works. But for 32-bit x86, it's somehow miscompiled, and not even LS works. LS is outputting some, at least, well, the file system, the file names are there, but the date is wrong. It's outputting some gibberish for the dates, for example, and bin utils doesn't work, but whatever. And then the what I want to make for an experience, which I was thinking already for quite some time in general for Linux embedded work, because we have, of course, core utils where we have like ls and cut and stuff and dd and all the low-level vintage Unix commands there that you use all day, and they are all implemented in C. And in my opinion, even there we sometimes had security vulnerabilities, no joke there. And for a test of this strategy, I will probably implement this commands like cp and copy, move and such in Lua, just for the fun of it, because for copy and such, for cut, dd, what do you need? You need open, read, write and stuff, and this is not even that performance sensitive. And then you would have these tools as a test bed also for bringing the system up. You can, and they would be totally portable. What do you need? You only need in your runtime this IOCTL lookup stuff, and then you would have open for most of these tools. They are so simple, not any fancy stuff there. And Then we would have here at least one set of test trial and error. Would even be surprising how fast they are or not. Maybe even then continue with my own Lua just interim compiler that is slightly different than Lua JIT, with this different strategy, testing that out, getting the code base running there. And then we have already quite some different things, bare metal, low level driver stuff, modern stuff, readable, to share, test, experiment on the user space side, this low-level commands that we anyway need, and maybe not. Of course, we can always port core utils and whatnot, but it would be a fun thing, in my opinion, also for the embedded stuff. It would be nice for embedded Linux to have there. Of course, there is BusyBox and the mbutils we have in T2, of course, both. BusyBox and mbutils, both the same concept, the small tools, but in my opinion, mbutils from Felix von Leitner are a little bit crappily written. You wonder those people who shout the loudest with their diet libs and such, at times not the most amazing formatted, written, readable, a little bit error prone, and sometimes even crashing C code. For example, mbutils mount is crashing when you do not, if you don't specify the options like mount T for file system something, if you don't specify some of the options, it's crashing. And if you specify them after the mount point, so you can't mount slash dev something t better fs or something, it's also crashing. And recently, so I fixed this already a little bit, so you see the biggest security people in the industry maybe sometimes write their not most outstanding C code there. Also diet libc a little bit. I was an early adapter of diet libc, the Felix von Leitner alternative minimalistic C library. But after a decade or 15 years, I have to say, I'm getting a little bit tired of this. Not as maintained, often crashing, not most readable and such code. And on Hewlett-Packard PA RISC, we have right now the situation that on boot, exactly this mount is crashing because it's passing some uninitialized memory to the option flag. So dash O option read only or something. It's passing some random memory to the kernel because I don't know what, either in diet libc or in mbutils, just to give you some overview what can go wrong in the small utilities. You think in this 10 lines of utilities not so much can go wrong, but anyway, these are the things I will probably do here sometime soon. And what I wanted to share also, I wonder on the grand scheme of UI stuff, I mean, beside, I really wonder, I also will continue with UI stuff, And by the way, if you have one UI server, of course, in the Linux kernel, everything is a little bit chaotic. You have the fbdev, kernel mode setting, and then, of course, a frame buffer due to that text scrolling, X server, Wayland, you name it, and all the Mesa 3D stuff in between and stuff. And if we have here one nicely window manager with all the stuff nicely integrated and in more modern way than the C-coded lib DRI, DRM, and drivers in the Linux kernel, you could even do fun stuff like overlays. Why would be, even if you only want a text console for your text geek stuff, even I personally often work on a text console because why not? You could even on such a system have a text console, like macOS can also boot in single user mode with a text console, for example, and you could have overlays, for like system-wide overlays, similar to the macOS taskbar thing there, with battery stuff, because just the usual central Berlin situation here. And you could have system-wide overlays. How often does it happen? I work, because often, honestly, when I work on low-level stuff, I often work on the virtual console, and it happened each month at least once that some system randomly shuts off because I don't realize that I'm running out of battery power. How amazing would be if you would have this Windows server with a text console thing, and you would have some Bluetooth wireless stuff independent of X server and Wayland and whatnot stuff there. This is all possible with such kind of thing. And even you could have a Quake, like this KDE UR Quake something. You could have at any point of time some low-level DMS kind of debug console scrolling down, because this would be your whole Windows server file system kind of thing. Really totally nice stuff you could do with this that right now is either difficult or error prone. Not even in Linux we still find with boot graphics, how many boot graphics stuff like themes and hiding stuff, and I even forgot the name, from Playmouth or Plymouth or whatever, and modern, I don't even, SUSE boot splash and kernel boot splash stuff, you name it. Can't even name names here of so many strange independent projects. And now they talk for 10 years of deleting the frame buffer drivers, when most of the embedded drivers are, of course, frame buffer. Really wonder, this is probably the reason why it's not deleted. I also wonder, then on Foronix, they always make a party when they have their frame buffer drivers soon deleted, and I wonder, why do you even want this, all these nice drivers from back in the day? Why would you delete them, and then you don't have all your vintage embedded and stuff embedded Linux drivers, no graphic anymore? So this is, yeah, you wonder sometimes what they discuss in the Linux kernel. But yeah, this is why I try to get here some more larger YouTube audience going. Or maybe I should try to find venture capital and promote here to the EU government to cash in here some million of funding for some next generation hyper secure buzzword laden microkernel server for, I don't know, the secret service or such. This would be ideas, either finance it with YouTube, finance it with cashing in on state funding, government projects and venture capital, or just hope that I get enough code written in my 20% plus time here and do fun stuff. But next we will continue with more bare metal stuff, as I said, and I hope these were some ideas that are interesting. Also other things that I really wonder, on the UI level, I really would like to see, and there I think we have not made much progress. Basically the modern UI wise, modern desktop is still similar to how the Windows was back in the day or such, with icons and metaphors. And what would be really nice, in my opinion, would be if we would have features like system void undo. This is really annoying in my opinion. Really wonder why this is not solved. One thing that is quite nice in macOS, the Safari, you have control set for opening, undoing, closing tabs, which I actually use quite often, but this is not system void undo. What I mean with system void undo is, how often do you do something on Android, on Linux, on Windows, wherever, and you do something and you want to undo it and you close the program, you don't even know how it happened. For example, you press some hotkey and some things there. It's so interesting concept that in my opinion would be nice to have. And maybe this is all this would of course not be easy, but this is just one example of that. I really wonder why has it not been done more, especially on the Linux side. Of course, we have GTK, KDE, NativeX, and so many other toolkits in between, FLTK and WX widgets and whatnot. And this is of course not helping integration wise, but in my opinion, system wide undo for whatever you want to undo, maybe some, for example, like system wide transaction registration or something. And then even if you close your email program, you delete an email, you close your email program or whatever, or it is already 15 minutes gone and can be everything, doesn't need to be deleting an email, can also be moving a file or deleting a file and whatnot. It would be really an interesting concept to have a more system-wide aware transaction mechanism to also roll back or undo individual things in between. Just some other interesting idea I wanted to mention that I really miss. I actually, now that I have here this Galaxy S10 and I'm the first timer on Android, although I had the Nexus 5, I recently wondered, I think I googled like undo text. I think there was like no undo text. Is this really true? I think I googled this Android text undo and was really surprised that there was no. So best when you type it right, then you really wonder if how to undo text. At least one thing I found that it was not possible. What if the problem is when you Google this here, how secure is input, what? And if this is true, even 7 years after launch, it still doesn't have one basic element, the ability to undo and redo text. At least in my 5 minutes, I've not found one. Really crazy. I mean, at least in macOS, it's of course shitty. There is criticism, like shaking this is really stupid. For text undo, I really hate this. Often it doesn't even work. Then you shake it a little bit, doesn't work. You shake it more. In my opinion, really stupid thing. I mean, in a way, it was slightly genius. It's like we don't have so much UI pixel elements there. But on the long term, it's really getting on the nerve to shake your phone to undo something. But if this is really true, that correct me if I'm wrong, maybe you can do it somehow. I clicked around, so I didn't find something on this Samsung Android skin, but there you wonder if this is really true. System-wide undo, in my opinion, would be this kind of concepts. In a way, when you look at this in Linux, what did really happen on the UI innovations the last decade? Leave me in the comments below. In Windows, they mostly took some stuff away, took bitmaps away, made everything flat, removed options, not really much innovation there, except each time I start Windows for a test, I find nothing. Everything is strangely sorted, hidden, you name it. I even had to Google how to change partitions on a modern system because somehow I didn't find it anywhere in the menu or the Finder Explorer. Of course, it was somewhere in the Explorer, Advanced Storage Management, something. But even if I need to Google how to access partition stuff in Windows, and you really wonder what they have done wrong. Often I use the search function on Windows to find something which works at least a little bit. Just some random ideas here, and leave me in the comments below what you think about this. Comments in the audience, where you're from, advert that it comes down to that poorly written C, C++ drivers, the poorly written drivers in Lua. Well, our drivers are quite well written, a really nice infrastructure we have there for our drivers, obviously, but yeah, the question is how long is our exact scan business going? Although I have the feeling people still produce enough paper that they still want to scan it. But I also, I said this already, I have done scanner drivers 20 years, initially only for Linux open source because I wanted to use my Avision scanner in 1998. And since then, the same driver grew to over 200 OEM scanners because Avision is one of the largest scanner manufacturers in Taiwan, manufacturing also for a whole bunch of other AAA brands like Hewlett-Packard, Visionear, Xerox, Kodak, Fujitsu, that repeatedly stick their name on there. This is why this is also many. But our new driver in Lua also for Genesis Logic low-level chips where you need to do everything low-level, and other Fujitsu and whatnot, other related scanners. And I'm not regretting this, completely amazing. You can also, and by the way, maybe the drivers in Lua are a little bit more better written because it's more readable and less error-prone and stuff like this. not saying this. Yes, I understand. I just wanted to give a summary. Maybe, of course, it is, can be always shittily written, but maybe it is easier to write better drivers if the language is in a little bit higher level. And again, I do not want to say this has to be everything Lua. I only want to give you some interesting idea. Of course, you can even write them in JavaScript or Java. Not that I want to say this is a good idea. Just that, but by the way, people even write driver kind of stuff in, like, you find people writing stuff in Python for driving some serial controlled microcontroller stuff, or this modern Arduino stuff and whatnot. And I'm getting a little bit tired that Linux is, when I take a look on this, everything, the Linux kernel developer break more stuff. For example, they have taken away the vintage Spark stuff from me. Spark Station 2 does not work. They deleted this in 3. Something. They have taken old-fashioned, regular, original 386 away. This is also deleted, needs at least a 486 with compare exchange instruction in the meantime. They have taken old-fashioned PowerPC prep, like PowerPC reference platform, something away. They have taken other stuff. What else have they? They have, of course, recently deleted Blackfin DSP because nobody cared enough. Not to mention that AVR32 never made it into the kernel. But at least as far as I remember. So they mostly take stuff away by refactoring it. And our ALSA stuff is also more often broken with regressions than not. Just to give you some data points. So, and in my opinion, this could have been avoided. Yes, you can do cleanups, but maybe, and in a microkernel, we would not have all of this sound and video and whatnot stuff in the microkernel. We had only a small layer of interrupt and resource management and allocation in there, in this pure, if I still have this nice Crusoe graphics. And by the way, but probably this is enough for today, 50 minutes live stream for this. You can also watch the previous live streams of this basic concepts. I will, as I said, I will continue with this bare metal stuff. I will also do VirtIO, so the virtual stuff in QEMU and whatnot, to have their VirtIO demos to run directly in emulated environments and such. Maybe even for the fun of it, do the NVIDIA, not NVIDIA, VMware, VGA, SVGA2 or what they call it, this VMware protocol stuff, and yeah, things like this. Leave me in the comments below what you think about this, also when you watch this archived and time-shifted video on demand. I hope you got here some inspiration. Maybe in general, the summary, think out of the box, try new things. Just because operating systems have been written in C for the most part does not mean they always have to be written in C. And when you take a look here on other interesting systems, BOS was quite snappy. I had this BOS personal edition from all this stuff that I don't find anymore. I'm not sure what we have done with this box. So I had this back in the day, was really quite snappy and nice. And there you really wondered, although it's somehow not loading right now for whatever internet delay reasons here, at least that it is... yeah, this is how it looked and was C++, I think, some hybrid kernel kind of thing. And I saw this on the CBIT. They had some really amazing 3D demos running there for back in the day. And of course, there is a Haiku successor. But in my opinion, this is not modern enough. This is still designed from still 20. If Linux is designed, as with all the C and monolithic stuff, Linux is honestly more like 30, 40 years in the past. Haiku is, of course, that was state of the art in BOS 20 years ago. Of course, nowadays, it's already 20 years ago. It is, in my opinion, time to move on further. And yeah, really sad that with this market dominance, we don't have more. Of course, we have quite some modern, not modern, we have quite some hobby things, but maybe the most modern is Haiku, maybe, and also maybe Dragonfly. BSD is said to be some hybrid kind of, but yeah, for the educational sake and my own personal experimentation, I will anyway pursue this route, make more demos and stuff, and anyway need to continue with my JIT compiler, because when I take a look there on LLVM ceiling, this stuff is huge in the meantime, and as slow as it is, you really wonder, or you actually don't have to wonder why it wasn't successful to use LLVM as a JIT backend in WebKit on Apple's side. They have in the meantime also their new JIT compiler there, because LLVM just was too slow for just in-time compilation of JavaScript. No surprise there. When you take a look on my today's live stream on my secondary channel, how slow Clang LLVM Clang there, Clang compiles stuff 25% slower than GCC8 or what's this worth. And yeah, so much to do, so much to do. Maybe leave me in the comments below if the feeling my pre-edited videos were a little bit more successful. Maybe I should switch back to this, less live content and more pre-edited summaries. I have the feeling, but leave me in the comments below what you like and dislike. What are your thoughts on this? And again, I think anyway with my low-level demos, anyway a nice thing for people to experiment with, especially if I ever manage to auction a Voodoo card below 100 euro or below 80 euro there for a real hardware demo sake. And otherwise, I hope you enjoyed this, learned something. And again, thanks for watching. And if you have comments to this, just leave them also in the below the video. And also for more live, the second channel, if you want to watch more random tinkering here. And have a good night, have a good day, wherever you are in the world. And I hope to see you soon for all the next videos and low-level development and research to come. And amazingly, we had zero drop frames, so maybe restarting our cable modem and running the TG3 driver without IOMMU really helps a little bit. Let's see how this continues to go.